As the trial of President William Clinton moved into the United States Senate, a trial of an American president for impeachment occurring only for the second time in this nation's history. The parallels between the impeachment of Andrew Johnson in 1868 and President Clinton have been raised by many. This was perhaps most forcefully stated by Representative Jesse Jackson, Jr., prior to the vote of the House of Representatives for those articles. And in doing so, he raised real issues of importance as to both cases, even if his understanding of the historical record was a bit incorrect. For it is one of the sad facts of history that the real story of the impeachment of President Johnson in 1868 is so totally misunderstood. As Representative Jackson pointed out, the issue then was the reconstruction of the nation after a bloody and divisive civil war, and that the issue today is very much the same. Such historical precedents offer a useful insight into today's proceedings, both its political context and the true legal standard this nation's founders intended as the law of impeachment, and thus how one former Tennessee senator, Andrew Johnson, should have been impeached, and how the Republican insurrectionists today behind the impeachment of President Clinton have more in common with Mr. Johnson than those patriots, all allies of the late Abraham Lincoln, who legitimately sought Johnson's removal. It also offers an enlightening and ironic parallel to what should be the true trial of bribery, treason, and other high crimes and misdemeanors today against Al Gore, another former Tennessee senator and vice president, who would himself be president as a result of what can only be described as a parliamentary assassination of his own president. While the articles of impeachment upon which President Johnson was ultimately tried in the US Senate were nonsensical, there is no question that Johnson deserved to be removed from office. His trial in the United States Senate occurred over his violation of a tenure in office act passed by Congress only months before. It was a relatively silly and dubious charge involving his removal of the Secretary of War, Edwin Stanton, from his post. This, however, was an operation managed by the very same forces who opposed the American system policies of Abraham Lincoln and his allies in Congress, a pro-British faction in the Republican Party. The original charges written by Thaddeus Stevens, an ally of Henry Carey and Abraham Lincoln, which never made it out of the House Judiciary Committee, were based on Johnson's real treasonous defense of the old order in the South and his obstruction of the Republican plan for the reconstruction of the South after the war. These circles saw the battle over Reconstruction as one that involved the very survival of this nation, and with it, the ultimate destruction of the British Empire. At the end of the war, after Union forces had successfully defeated the Confederacy, the issue of how these states, the seceded states of the Confederacy, were going to be returned to the Union. This was a pressing question. Having defeated the forces that would have destroyed this nation, the forces of British free trade and oligarchism on the battlefield, Abraham Lincoln and his allies fully intended to ensure their defeat politically as well. Not only would every remnant of such policies be eliminated in the South, but in conjunction with Russia, which had helped to ensure that Britain not intervene on the side of the Confederacy during the war, and a Germany committed to the policies of Friedrich List, an American nation recommitted to the outlook of the American system would be the centerpiece of a growing alliance that would destroy oligarchical power globally. As Henry Carey, who had been the architect of Lincoln's economic policies, wrote in a series of open letters on Reconstruction to Senator Henry Wilson of Massachusetts, quote, "British policy looks to arrest the circulation of the world by means of compelling all raw materials produced to pass through its little workshop. It is a monopoly system, and therefore it is that poverty, disease, and famine, all of which unite for the production of slavery, are chronic diseases in every country wholly subjected to British influence. Therefore, too, has it been that British agents have always been in such close alliance with the slaveholding aristocracy of the South, and that throughout the late war, British public opinion has been so nearly universally on the side of the men who have publicly proclaimed that slavery was to be regarded as the proper cornerstone of all free institutions. British free trade, industrial monopoly, and human slavery travel together. And the man who undertakes the work of reconstruction without having first satisfied himself that such is certainly the fact will find that he has been building on shifting sands and must fail to produce an edifice that will be permanent. But what happened was something quite different. Abraham Lincoln was assassinated by the very British and British allied forces who had run secession, bringing Andrew Johnson, his vice president, to the presidency. Using his wartime military powers as commander-in-chief, Johnson announced he would appoint provisional governors in each of the southern states, giving them the power to arrange elections for constitutional conventions in each state, and to do everything, as he said in his proclamation, quote, necessary and proper to enable these states to resume their constitutional relations to the federal government. The object was to establish new governments, supposedly Republican in character. However, as you will see, these new governments would be created by the very same traitors who had controlled them in the first place, waging a war to destroy the Union. This was contrary to the view of the Republican leadership in Congress, and had been the view of Lincoln throughout the war that Congress would have to enact legislation to give any such process constitutional authority. Some saw it as a usurpation of congressional power, but it was a great deal more. For in conjunction with his repudiation of Lincoln's American system policies, what it truly amounted to following Lincoln's assassination was a British coup d'etat. What this process ultimately produced made this even clearer. The provisions of his proclamation were vague and therefore gave great latitude for interpretation by his appointed provisional governors. They were instructed that each state should repeal the state's ordinances of secession, should repudiate all debt incurred while in rebellion, both of the Confederate and individual state governments, and finally, that they should recognize the abolition of slavery. Three simple steps for readmission. However, these amounted to really mere suggestions to these provisional governors, to whom he had given very broad and ill-defined powers, which pretty much allowed them to decide for themselves how this process of reorganization was to occur. And like himself, these provisional governors might have been anti-secession unionists, but were not really committed to changing the South in any fundamental way. First of all, as these governments were organized under Johnson's proclamation, as these new governments would be formed under presidential reconstruction, not one of them, and not one of the constitutions of any of these new state governments adopted any provision for black suffrage. Every southern state legislature enacted legislation to protect the old order and to effectively negate the requirement of recognizing the abolition of slavery. On top of Johnson's pardoning power, there were voting requirements enacted and gerrymandering that limited the power of pro-Union Southerners as well. Additionally, each of these new state governments enacted residency requirements for voting and office holding that would disenfranchise those who had opposed secession and left the South. Now, this was very important. Most people don't realize this, but over 100,000 white Southerners fought in the Union Army. They didn't wear gray. Every state in the Confederacy, with the exception of South Carolina, had whites fighting for the Union. They obviously were not at home, residing in their respective states while they were fighting in the Union Army. So tens of thousands of loyal Southerners were disqualified from voting. Or Southerners who had fought politically against the Confederacy. And many of these people were run out. If they weren't actually killed, they had been driven out of the South. And they as well couldn't meet these residency requirements. It also applied to Northerners, both black and white, who in the thousands, tens of thousands, were coming south at the end of the war to help in the process of reconstructing and developing this area. They were disqualified from voting as well. But the most outrageous of these laws, however, were the black codes, which were legislation that every single southern state passed, which set up a series of measures which effectively reestablished the institution of slavery under another guise. They provided for what former slaves could and could not do in terms of employment. For example, slaves were not allowed to develop skilled, craft-oriented professions. They provided for where former slaves could live and where they couldn't live. There were certain sections of cities where former slaves were not allowed to live, and there were other sections where they were. But the most horrid aspect of the Black Codes, however, were the vagrancy laws. These established an unbelievable provision that allowed virtually anyone to be classified as a vagrant. And what I want to do is just read you a section from one of these statutes. The vagrancy statute, this is from the vagrancy statute of the Mississippi Black Codes. It defined any former slave, any freedman, many of these actually went under the guise of legislation to enhance the rights and privileges of the newly freedman. They defined any former slave who was not, quote, who was not gainfully employed, which was with many of these were. I mean, with the end of the plantation system, the collapse of the plantation system after emancipation, huge numbers of former slaves were not gainfully employed because the system had collapsed. Or, quote, any stubborn or refractory servant, a laborer or servant who loiters away his time or refuses to comply with any contract or term of service, was a vagrant. And under the Black Codes, vagrants were subject to arrest and punishment by being hired out by the county sheriff for a term of anywhere from 6 months to a year. So effectively, what had occurred was that the very slaves who had worked on these plantations prior to the end of the war, now, while no longer legally property, so-called property, under the Black Code vagrancy statutes, could be put to work and were en masse on the very same plantations, under the very same slave masters who now ran their governments, because they had been given the right to vote and run for office by Johnson's pardons. And what you had is a system which, it very quickly became clear, was of the very type that the Civil War had been fought to destroy. These policies were precisely the ones that had impelled the nation to war. Now, this was the point at which the fight between Johnson and the Congress fully erupted. I'm not going to go into all the details because we don't have time tonight, but the bottom line was any sane American, any American who had seen over 625,000 Americans give their lives in a war over the principles of the Constitution, that notion that all men are created equal and that this horrible British-based slave system in the South would be destroyed, was not going to sit there and let the vice president of the former Confederacy, 4 Confederate generals, 5 Confederate colonels, 6 former cabinet members, and 58 former members of the Confederate Congress enter the United States Congress as representative from their respective states. So what the Congress did is it rejected all of them. It said that these newly elected congressmen and senators were not representative and therefore could not be seated. Now, Johnson's view was that the measures passed by Congress were all unconstitutional, you know, that they violated the rights of these poor, defenseless Southerners who only months, in many cases before, had waged war against the nation, right, and were actively engaged in what effectively amounted to another insurrection against the nation in the form of the terror that was being carried out by the Ku Klux Klan and other similar organizations, organizations similar to what Tony described as the insurrectionist who carried the South out in the first place. And he took it upon himself as the president to actively organize to ensure that Congress's plan was destroyed and that his outlook and that of these Southern oligarchs, these traitors and secessionists, would be reestablished. Now, there is a lot of background to Johnson which one could go through. But the bottom line is he had all the earmarks of a British agent. He was an advocate of free trade. He was against the American system, passionately against the American system. And he didn't fundamentally want to see any change in the South. One wonders how he ended up as Lincoln's running mate in 1864 and therefore his vice president. But American presidents sometimes end up, oftentimes end up, with really bad vice presidents. And they generally tend to be the ones who get shot, because the British understand that they've got a fairly good backup option, as is the case today. As the battle heightened, President Johnson then began to systematically attack the authority of the Congress itself. During that period, there were massive numbers of federal employees that were appointees. For example, then every postal employee in the United States was appointed by the President of the United States. And this was generally done with the assistance of Congress. For example, the President would go to a congressman in Philadelphia and say, look, I've got to appoint postmasters, postal inspectors, I've got to appoint a tariff collector in the customs office. Who do you think should get these appointments? And that's generally how this was done. And Lincoln had done that, and most of the people who were in these federal positions were people who supported Lincoln and the policies of Lincoln and the Lincoln core of the Republican Party, and as a result supported the congressional view of what should happen in the South. Johnson began to fire them en masse and replace them with people who were supporters of his. And as Thaddeus Stevens very appropriately pointed out in a speech on the floor of Congress, what Andrew Johnson was doing was in fact building a political base for himself that was based on the very combination that had practically just destroyed the nation: Southern aristocrats and Northern copperheads, the two centers of British-based subversion in America. That's who Andrew Johnson's supporters were. He, in fact, was repudiating the base of the political party that had put him in office. So what Congress did is they moved to impeach him. Now, most people have this simple outline of how it actually happened. Johnson took Stanton, Edwin Stanton, who was the Secretary of War, and he removed him from office. Stanton had been Lincoln's Secretary of War, and Johnson, therefore, had inherited him, as with the rest of Lincoln's cabinet. He had been a supporter. Stanton had been a supporter of congressional reconstruction, and because of the crucial role of the military in congressional reconstruction, Johnson wanted to get rid of him. In response, Congress had passed, approximately 6 months earlier, a law that prohibited the president from doing such a thing. It was called the Tenure in Office Act. But that was not the basis upon which Johnson was to be impeached. That was not the basis on which he should have been impeached. It was an operation that was thrown in the works to effectively sabotage a real, principled indictment of the president. What had actually happened was that Thaddeus Stevens and the people around him wrote a series of articles of impeachment that actually clearly outlined the character of why Johnson should be impeached. And I believe in the process created the standard by which anyone who looks at impeachment has to look at it today. The speeches of Thaddeus Stevens on the floor of the United States House of Representatives during this period are certainly among them. And there I found a draft of these proposed articles of impeachment, which were initially those discussed by the Judiciary Committee of the day that was preparing the indictment of President Johnson. This is actually prior to the indictment that was actually voted up by the House in 1868. The second article of those, the second article in that draft reads as follows. On the second day of March 1867, Congress passed an act entitled "An Act to Provide for the More Efficient Government of the Rebel States," and subsequently several supplements thereto, all intended to enable said people of the conquered territory to form constitutions and governments republican in form for themselves, so that they might gain readmission into the Union upon equal terms with the other states of the United States. And after Congress had passed the same laws by a two-thirds vote over his veto, he denounced and continued to denounce them as unconstitutional and advised resistance to them, whereby he has thus far impeded the establishment of regular governments within said territories. And on the 19th day of July, 1867, Congress passed an act supplementary thereto and explanatory to the previous acts already quoted, and in and by which it declared that the governments then existing in Virginia, North Carolina, and other parts of the conquered territory were not legal governments and ought not to be obeyed, and that the president continued to treat them as legal governments, to recognize the governors and other officials for them heretofore appointed by himself, and to encourage them to disobey the law aforesaid. In other words, Johnson was breaking the law of the United States. Now, there's nothing that prevents a president politically from speaking out against policies he believes are wrong. But to actually remove officials from office who are trying to implement legislation duly passed by Congress, to sabotage policies on which the very future of the nation itself depends, that's a different story. When a law is passed, you as the commander-in-chief, excuse me, you as the chief executive, are responsible for its enforcement, whether you vetoed it initially or not. It is passed by a two-thirds, and if you veto it, and if it's passed by a two-thirds majority, it is law. So the second article of this bill of impeachment was this direct obstruction, was on this direct obstruction of the law of the land as represented by acts passed by Congress. Now, I assume that the first one drafted by Stevens, which no longer exists, was along similar lines. The third proposed article reads as follows. Andrew Johnson, having been elected to office as a Republican holding the same principles as Abraham Lincoln, did after the death of the said Abraham Lincoln conspire to continue in office another term, and in order to enable him to do so, he sought to build up a party distinct from and antagonistic to the one which elected him. And to that end, he perverted the patronage of the government, which he held by virtue of his office of in public trust. He attempted to corrupt and did corrupt many of the people by exchanging offices within his gift for their principles. As Stevens actually put it in his arguments, when a president, whether willfully or not, acts in a fashion to actually subvert the interests of the nation and his people. So in contradistinction to what's being done to President Clinton today, I think it's also useful to look at this from the standpoint of the character, what policies actually represent those of the American system. And the essence of what we see going on today is that the same British-sponsored enemies of this nation would attempt to remove President Clinton from the standpoint of directly imposing the kinds of policies which this nation throughout its history fought to destroy, including the policies that the current Vice President of the United States supports. The man who would become the President of the United States. And this represents one of the worst travesties in American history. It's ludicrous. The irony is that the very policies which Lincoln's Vice President, who became President of the United States at the end of the war through his assassination, supported, are the very policies that the people who are trying to impeach Bill Clinton are trying to impose on this nation. Think of the irony. The power of impeachment being used to remove a president then because of the issues of reconstruction of the old Confederacy, and the attempt to impeach this president because the same issue exists today, the issue of the reconstruction of a new Confederacy. That's something that people have to remember. We are waging a fight against those who are committed to the very same system, and it's a global system, as Lincoln, Stevens, Carey, and their allies clearly understood 131 years ago. And the role of the American nation state in that fight is pivotal, which is why Mr. LaRouche has made the point again and again that if this president is destroyed, if he is removed from office, if he is assassinated, this world has very, very little chance of survival. And in reading some of the things which Thaddeus Stevens said after the fact, his view, which was the view of circles around Carey, the core supporters of Lincoln and the Republican Party, their view was that the issue then was the very survival of this nation, and with it the survival of all of mankind. That was what was at stake at the end of the Civil War.
Do you solemnly swear that in all things appertaining to the trial of the impeachment of William Jefferson Clinton, President of the United States, now pending, you will do impartial justice according to the Constitution and laws, so help you God.
I do.
We are here because we have a system of government based on the rule of law, a system of government in which no one is above the law.
First, perjury and obstruction of justice drive a stake in the heart of the rule of law.
I conclude that when all is said and done, I must vote to impeach President William Jefferson Clinton. To do otherwise would undermine the rule of law.
Everything that is special and unique about our country is built on and protected by one principle, the rule of law.
There is no business of government more important than upholding the rule of law.
Protecting the Constitution, protecting the rule of law.
And establish the rule of law.
We were told there are three pillars to the rule of law, an honest judiciary, an ethical bar, and an enforceable oath. And this is why the president's lying under oath is so serious. It is an assault on the rule of law.
What are they talking about? That was the question that I was asking myself in watching and reading the proceedings in the House and in the Senate around the impeachment trial. And that's the genesis of this presentation tonight. I knew that there was something very rotten about this concept of the rule of law, because if you've read any American history or constitutional law, this was not a phrase that was used at the time of the drafting of the Constitution, at the time of the Revolution. It was not used, as far as I'm aware, in any of the discourse in the 19th century. And it began to seep into discourse in the 20th century and has become particularly prominent in the post-war period, and especially in the past few years. The premise of this is, although most people won't state it, but the unstated premise of this is that this idea of the rule of law, that this is Anglo-American law, this is our Anglo-American heritage, that there's one body, sort of a seamless tradition of Anglo-American law from Magna Carta up through the American Revolution up to the present day. Simply put, this is a way of denying that there is anything unique about our American Constitution and about the system of law that flows from that. To put it bluntly, talk about the rule of law is treason to our Constitution. It's treason to our nation. And I think that the people we've just seen up here, we will see, are indicting themselves by what they have done, not only overall in the impeachment process, but particularly the way they framed it. So let's put them on trial tonight. The modern nation state is the most suitable form of organization of human society and the most appropriate to a society which is premised on the notion of all men and women having been created in the image of God. This is the only form of organization of society in which the potential of every individual to develop and to realize his or her cognitive powers of mind, the divine spark of reason, can potentially be realized. All forms of oligarchical society, including feudalism, the one perhaps closest to us today, are based upon relegating a large portion of their subject population to the status of beast of burden or chattels, serfs, slaves, or slave labor. In other words, 95% of the population is less than human. And what goes along with this is the idea that some ruling strata or ruling class, an aristocracy, a landed oligarchy, or even some administrative bureaucracy, has some arbitrary authority, some lawmaking authority, over the rest of society. There can be no notion of truth or no notion of justice in such an arrangement. The principle of law, to the extent you can say any principle exists at all, is purely arbitrary, even if it's codified, embodied in a set of rules or positive law which are said, well, this makes it not arbitrary, we have all these rules, is still arbitrary because the very principle is arbitrary. There is no principle of truth, there is no principle of justice inherent in this. By way of contrast, the Republican conception of law proceeds not from the standpoint of perpetuating the rule of a ruling strata or oligarchy, but it proceeds from the standpoint of what our Constitution calls the general welfare, maintaining and improving the conditions of life of the entire population by increasing the individual's power over nature and over the universe. This is accomplished in the modern nation state through universal education, higher standards of living, and scientific and technological progress. In a nutshell, this is the distinction between John Locke's notion of life, liberty, and property and the Leibnizian conception of life, liberty, and happiness, which is embodied in our Declaration of Independence and inherent in our federal constitution. Now, the question for us is, how can you have a common rule of law between such different forms of society, between an oligarchical form of society based on 95% of the population being held in one or another form of serfdom or slavery, and a republican society based on man in the image of God? How can you have, more specifically, some sort of common rule of law between the British system, which was and is to this day an oligarchical system, and the United States, which fought a revolution against that system and established a constitution which overturned the entire British system? Our constitution is definitely not that of John Locke. Locke did draft a constitution. It was for South Carolina. It established slavery. It established hereditary nobility and so forth. That's fundamentally in total contradistinction to what we have as our federal constitution. But those who prattle on about the rule of law will discuss this as if this is one and the same thing. Now, Len, in his Road to Recovery paper, he identifies the positive functions performed by the modern nation state. He identifies five such functions, or what he calls the physical benefits. These being, first, the assertion of national sovereignty as such, the power to defend the republic and its people from the overreaching power of alien, that is, oligarchical forms, either domestic or foreign. And this obviously includes the military power of the sovereign state. The power to create and defend institutions of national currency and credit, not subject to any external agency, such as the IMF, the World Bank, etc. And to defend currency and production from undesirable either foreign or domestic practices. And this obviously includes protective tariffs, the power to legislate and implement labor standards and things of that sort. Thirdly, to maintain and improve the conditions of the population, and of the national territory, including matters such as public health, as well as public improvements, or what we today call infrastructure. Fourth, to foster science progress in science, in technology, and in the arts through universal education. And fifth, to foster investment in scientific and technological progress in capital-intensive and power-intensive modes. And this can be accomplished by means of tax policies, tax credit policies, regulatory policies, and so forth. These are things that the modern sovereign nation state does, and when done properly, can do very well. Now, if you want to destroy the republican character of the nation state, or more specifically, destroy the republican character of our Constitution, how would you do it? Well, you would get rid of these specific things that Lynn has identified. First thing you would do, I think, would be get rid of the preamble itself, which we've often identified as the most important component or part of our Constitution. That is, we the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, to establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. Well, the first thing you would do is you would get rid of the idea of the more perfect union. You would get rid of the general welfare clause. Then, going through others of Lynn's points in terms of the benefits, the positive functions of the modern nation state, you could get rid of the common defense clause. You could, with respect to national currency and credit and defending production, you could prohibit specifically tariffs, tax policy, and so forth, which could be used to promote or foster any branch of industry. You would narrow the interpretation of powers to make sure that the government could not create a national bank, which in 1819, John Marshall, in his famous decision, Maryland versus McCulloch, McCulloch versus Maryland, said that this was among the powers of the federal government under the necessary and proper clause of Article 2, Section 8. You would prohibit the appropriation of funds for any internal improvements or infrastructure, which would, any internal improvements that were designed to facilitate commerce. You would prohibit taxation to provide for the general welfare. You'd give the president a line item veto part of the, and then you would require a balanced budget. Now, if you haven't figured out by now, this is not just a theoretical exercise. This was done in 1861, and what I've described is exactly how the Confederate Constitution was drafted. All those provisions that I just mentioned you would take out and rip out were taken out to create the Confederate Constitution of 1861, to turn that from a Republican instrument into an instrument of oligarchical law. They did more than that. They also, I mean, they didn't just take things out. They added a lot more to make this into a much more detailed type of instrument, so that it took on much more of the character of positive law rather than constitutional law. On this question of rule of law, then, how can you have some sort of a common notion, right, between these two very conflicting ideas of law? Now, when I heard this impeachment proceeding began, I began to look at this, think about it. I knew it was pretty rotten, but I only a week or two ago began to actually look into this. Now, if you go to a library, as I did, and you poke around on this, you'll find, not very much, but you'll find some books and some old English books and British things and so forth. You might find one, for example, which is called The Rule of Law in Britain from the Roman Occupation to the Present Day. And this, the first sentence of this book is that Britain was given its first experience of a rule of law during the four centuries of the Roman occupation. You'll also find books that trace it back to Aristotle, debating whether Hobbes or Locke, you know, made the greatest contribution to establishing the rule of law and so forth. But you get the gist of this. Now, besides these characters of the House managers and these characters babbling on about the rule of law, the other place that I had come across this, and I'm just going to sort of trace out how I came into this, was through the American Bar Association's a group called the Standing Committee on Law and National Security. This is the newsletter. Across the top, it says National Security Law Report. This is from only last summer, July 1998. The front page is a tribute to Lewis F. Powell, the former and recently deceased Associate Justice of the Supreme Court, promoting the rule of law. But I then began to say, okay, where did this group come from? And I went back and looked at how this thing developed. And this is very useful in seeing how this rule of law idea came into prominence. It came out of two special committees of the American Bar Association. One went back to the 1950s, and it was called the Special Committee on Communist Tactics, Strategy, and Objectives. And those of you who remember the 50s, particularly the 50s and into the 60s, the anti-communist Red Scare propaganda, this is all stuff put out and sponsored by these people, the Overstreet's, Fred Schwartz, J. Edgar Hoover's books on communism and so forth. And what they did, they wrote about the Fifth Amendment lawyers who defended communists and so forth. It was Red Scare propaganda. And this is how they began to talk about the so-called rule of law. 1957, to give you another idea of these people, at the annual meeting of the American Bar Association, their report began with a report from the Privy Council, the British Privy Council, the Conference of Privy Councillors on Security, which had been presented in 1957? Which was presented by the Privy Councillors to the Prime Minister, to the Parliament in London. And this went through and talked about, in the context of the communist danger, the basic principles which ever must be observed under the system of Anglo-Saxon jurisprudence. And this then becomes part of this American Bar Association resolution passed in that year directly out of the Privy Council. Now, in 1961, Lewis Powell, who they talk about as promoting the rule of law, was instrumental in setting up a second group, which was called the Special Committee on Education, on the contrast between communism and liberty under law. And this statement of purpose said that we must preserve and constantly extend the rule of law. So what they are shaping here is a notion that the rule of law is the Anglo-American rule of law, is the alternative to communism. So this included Lewis Powell, it included Lewis Nichols of the FBI, and it included an attorney named Rush H. Limbaugh, who I looked up, and it turns out is the grandfather of the talk show Blowhard Today, Rush, contemporary Rush Fatso. Both his father and grandfather were lawyers, and his grandfather was very active in these intelligence circles in the American Bar Association, these international law groups, and so forth. Now, besides that, the funding of this thing, where do you think they got their money from? First of all, the most prominent founder throughout the 50s and the 60s of this group, up to the present day, is the Scaife Foundations, Richard Mellon Scaife. Not only the primary bankroller of the assault on the presidency against President Clinton, but in the 1980s, the principal bankroller of the Get LaRouche task force as well. Then I remembered a book that Tony Chaikin had bequeathed to me after he finished off Dick Morris in the period of the 1996 campaign. This was a book by a lawyer, a former president of the American Bar Association, whose name was Charles Rhyne, R-H-Y-N-E. He had worked with Dick Morris's father, Eugene Morris, and others of these characters in the World Peace Through Law Project and things of this sort. So this book really sort of unraveled the whole ball of wax, or unlocked the whole puzzle of this thing. The centerpiece of this, of what Charles Rhyne talks about in this book, was the annual meeting of the American Bar Association in 1957, which took place naturally in London. They traipsed 3,000 American lawyers over to London to meet with 3,000 British lawyers and privy counselors and MPs and every Lord Chancellors and everything else to celebrate Anglo-American law. Now, Rhyne, already in the 40s and 50s, he had a standard speech he would go around giving, saying that the great challenge facing particularly the legal profession, was to develop an informed public opinion behind the program to defeat the Soviet Union, and that the rule of law was that program to defeat communism and the Soviet Union, that the rule of law was the substitute for the rule of force. So this was the ideology of his and other characters. The commemorative volume that the ABA put out on this London meeting stated that the lasting significance of this London meeting stemmed from the elements of the reaffirmation of faith in the rule of law as the greatest force for peace in the world, and the strengthening of ties between the two nations, i.e. Britain and the United States, which shoulder much of the burden for preserving a world order predicated upon law and justice. Now, the highlight of this meeting was the dedication of a memorial to Magna Carta on Runnymede Meadow along the Thames. This, what you see there, the sort of rotunda with the pillars, this was paid for by contributions from the American Bar Association, designed by them, and dedicated, and you have thousands there of British and American lawyers and God knows what else, on Runnymede Meadow, commemorating the extraction of Magna Carta from King John in the year 1215. Now, Charles Rhyne told a story in his book of how this came about, and he takes credit for being the person that came up with this idea. He had been at one point a special counsel to President Eisenhower, and Charles Rhyne had consulted with Eisenhower about the meeting was coming up in a couple of years in London. These things are planned well in advance. And he wanted to have some sort of a, in 1925, I think, the American Bar Association had put a monument or memorial to Blackstone, the great theorist of the common law. So he wanted to do something this time along those lines. So Eisenhower said he couldn't think of anything at the moment, but he suggested that to Ryan, he said to him, read Winston Churchill's recent speech at Westminster College in Fulton, Missouri. In that speech, Eisenhower told Ryan, Churchill mentions every subject that England and the United States have in common. It's a long speech, but you may get an idea out of it.
If all British moral and material forces and convictions are joined with your own in fraternal association, the high roads of the future will be clear. Not only for us, but for all. Not only for our time, but for a century to come.
Now, if you couldn't understand that through his mumbling, as Len says, they trained him this way. What he said, this was the concluding line of the speech. Unfortunately, we don't have the whole speech on tape. But he said, if all British moral and material forces and convictions are joined with your own, that is, the Americans, in fraternal association, the high roads of the future will be clear, not only for us, but for all, not only for our time, but for a century to come. Now, earlier in the speech, I mean, this is the famous Iron Curtain speech, but there's also some other features of it which are, I think, more important. Because this is where Roosevelt put forward the idea of the Anglo-American special relationship, Churchill, against the Soviet Union. Of course, this is in complete and direct opposition to Franklin Roosevelt's vision of the post-war world. As Roosevelt had said, he was not fighting the Second World War to preserve the British Empire. And Roosevelt, of course, wished to preserve, in the post-war period, the wartime Allied alliance with the Soviet Union. So the Cold War was not Roosevelt's strategy. This was Churchill's strategy. And playing on this Anglo-American tradition and the special relationship was his way of manipulating the United States into this project. Now, what he said, additionally, in this speech, he says, but we must never cease to proclaim in fearless tones the great principles of freedom and the rights of man, which are the joint inheritance of the English-speaking world, and which through Magna Carta, the Bill of Rights, the habeas corpus, trial by jury, and the English common law find their most famous expression in the American Declaration of Independence. That's what he said. And then he said, this is the message of the British and American peoples to mankind. He said as well that in terms, he at this point was proposing the creation of the United Nations with an Air Force, which is what he wanted at the time. And he said that neither the sure prevention of war nor the continuous rise of world organization will be gained without what I have called the fraternal association of English-speaking peoples. This means a special relationship between the British Commonwealth and Empire and the United States. So that is the genesis in the post-war period of this idea, and this as well is the genesis of this modern conception, this post-war conception of the rule of law going back to Magna Carta. Now, Lynn references this Magna Carta in his Road to Recovery paper. Will Wirtz talked about this afternoon a bit as well. And what this was, and this great Charter of Liberty, as it's called, was a restoration of the power of the feudal landlords as against the king, and the assertion that the king himself was not sovereign in his own land, but that he was simply a magistrate exerting power by the consents of the landlords. And as Len says, this is anarchy. Now, if you look at Magna Carta, there's 63 articles. Most of this deals with land, with property, inheritance, things of that sort. What is most often cited is Article 39 of Magna Carta, the one which is now said to to guarantee trial by jury. What it says is that no free man, that is to say, only free men this applied to, not serfs, not most of the population, no free man shall be taken or imprisoned or dispossessed or outlawed or banished or in any way destroyed, nor will we go upon him nor send upon him except by the legal judgment of his peers or the law of the land. Now, people today babble about this as if this means, well, this means trial by jury and a jury of your peers. Now, what peers meant there was peers in the sense of the House of Lords as being the peers, that you could not be judged by anyone of a lower social class than you, so that a nobleman could not be judged by anyone who ranked below the social rank of a nobleman. You're certainly not a serf or a peasant or anything else. Secondly, judgment did not mean jury, whether you were guilty or not guilty. What judgment meant was the method of trial. And trial did not necessarily mean trial by jury. It could mean trial by combat, trial by battle, trial by ordeal, any number of things. And trial by ordeal was you could tie somebody up and throw them into a pond or a lake, and if they came back to the surface and survived, then they were innocent. If they drowned, they were guilty. Trial by combat as well. If you lost, per se, you were guilty. By ordeal, you could have to carry in your bare hands a hot rock or molten iron, and if you got infected and died, you were guilty. If you survived, you're innocent. So the Virginia system. So this is what is always cited as, you know, the great progenitor of due process of law. This is what it actually meant. And a jury of your peers means that, you know, if you're a nobleman, that a group of nobles will decide if you're accused of something, by what method, ordeal, battle, whatever, your trial will be held. So it has very little to do with what people think of it, talk about it meaning today. It certainly has nothing to do with any notion of republican law. Now, Alexander Hamilton understood this quite well. In Federalist number 84, he argued against the need for a Bill of Rights in the Constitution. What Hamilton said is that he said Bill of, he not only said it wasn't necessary, but he said, in fact, it could be dangerous. Hamilton said, and I quote him here, he said, "Bills of Rights are, in their origin, stipulations between kings and their subjects, abridgments of prerogative in favor of privilege, reservation of rights not surrendered to the prince. Such was Magna Carta, obtained by the barons, sword in hand from King John." And he goes on and he cites the Petition of Right and other, the Declaration of Rights from the 1688 so-called Glorious Revolution and so forth. And then Hamilton says, "It is evident that these have no application to constitutions professedly founded upon the power of the people and executed by their immediate representatives and servants. Here, in strictness, the people surrender nothing, and as they retain everything, they have no need of particular reservations." And then Hamilton said that the notion of a Bill of Rights, or putting it, which is a way of putting us in positive law, is not only unnecessary, but it could be dangerous. Because he said this would contain various exceptions to powers not granted, and on this very account would afford a colorable pretext to claim more than were granted. So Hamilton understood this very well, right? Which no one today does, that this idea of a Bill of Rights and this screwy so-called Anglo-American conception of Bill of Rights, of liberties, and so forth, has nothing to do with our law. Right? And this obviously was not understood by these 3,000 lawyers and the rest of them who were gathered on Runnymede Meadow in 1957 with the memorial to Magna Carta. So that is what the rule of law amounts to. I mean, it's not just the Confederate Constitution, but it goes back to this crazy idea of the Anglo-American legal tradition. So to conclude my case, I would like to call again Henry Hyde to the witness stand.
Let's be clear. The vote you are asked to cast is, in the final analysis, a vote about the rule of law. The rule of law is one of the great achievements of our civilization. For the alternative to the rule of law is the rule of raw power. We here today are the heirs of 3,000 years of history in which humanity slowly and painfully and at great cost evolved a form of politics in which law, not brute force, is the arbiter of our public destinies. We're the heirs of the Ten Commandments and the Mosaic Law, a moral code for a free people who, having been liberated from bondage, saw in law a means to avoid falling back into the habits of slaves. We're the heirs of Roman law, the first legal system which peoples of different cultures, languages, races, and religions came to live together to form a political community. Oh, we're the heirs of the Magna Carta, by which the free men of England began to break the arbitrary and unchecked power of royal absolutism. We're the heirs of a long tradition of parliamentary development in which the rule of law gradually came to replace royal prerogative as the means for governing a society of free men and free women.
So I submit to you that by his own words, Henry Hyde has incriminated himself as guilty of treason against our Constitution and against the United States. So in the words that you heard yesterday, guilty or not guilty, what say you, citizens? A just verdict.